Hey, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co. And this is a new video for me. This is a new... call it a series. I don't know if it will or won't become a series in the end. But at least for today, it's a series. And in the future, I'll probably do more like this if I have titles I can talk about. And you probably know more than... you know, you probably know more from the title of this video than from what I'm saying here. Because I hopefully title it something informative. Maybe top 10 upcoming Kickstarters you should be paying attention to. That's way too long. I won't be calling it that. I'll figure something out later, but that's future Alex's problem. For right now, we're talking about top 10 upcoming Kickstarters you should be paying attention to, specifically from those that I've played, games that I have had the opportunity to play, and I'm excited about because I've played them. Because I'm not guaranteeing that I'll add these games to my collection. Many of them I have not had the opportunity, I'd say most of them, I have not had the opportunity to actually dive into them and review them and fully engage in them. Rather, they are games that I got my first play in with the publisher in terms of prepping to get a prototype, to get a review, and I got my first play in, and I had a great first experience with the game such that I believe these are games worth paying attention to. My opinion can change. Sometimes it will. It wouldn't be the first time I played a game once, was enamored after play one, and then play two was more of the same, and so it was less enamored. That can happen. So this is not a guarantee. These aren't reviews. These are first impressions after at least one play, in some cases more than one play, but in most cases after one play. And that's a long enough tangent to really dive in. But as usual, in Board Game Co. fashion, I will have an 11th title on this list, and that's specifically because I'm covering Chai Tea for Two. Now, why is this an 11th title? Because this one's going up, I have to double check the exact date, but it's going up pretty soon. Like, as in, you know, the next 2 weeks pretty soon. And it's entirely possible, based on when I'm filming this video and when this goes up, that this video will go up after it launches. Possible. I don't think so, but just in case, I threw it in as an 11th. And Chai Tea for Two is going to be a two-player version of Chai. Now, this is one that I actually have gotten multiple plays in already, because this one is one that I have the prototype. In fact, this is not planned, but I happen to have the prototype right next to me over here. So I got my multiple plays in. Review coming soon. Probably before, again, if this video goes up after, then you have already seen the review. But that's neither here nor there. But Chai Tea for Two is a two-player version of the game Chai. And it's a game that I walked into it knowing. I was told by Dan, by the designer of the game, that it was a tighter version of Chai. Whereas Chai is much more of a lighter, accessible gateway game, Chai Tea for Two is much more tense back and forth, tactical planning and decisions. And I walked in knowing that, but still being a little bit hesitant. Hesitant not that it would be a bad game, but that it would be a game that might not be right for me. It might still be too light. Chai, after all, is a game that I'm keeping because my daughter wants to keep it, not because I want to keep it. I think it's good. I don't think it's great. Chai Tea for Two, on the other hand, I think is great. I'll have a full review coming soon, or already, because wibbly wobbly timey wimey and all that. But Chai Tea for Two has a much greater degree of tension in the gameplay, that you're placing your dice. Your dice are your workers. You roll your dice. You place them in various spots on the board to gather tea, and then you're trying to get these movement cards to move tea up to where they eventually will be loaded onto boats. There's a lot of optimization, a lot of worker placement, a lot of back and forth as you try to min-max and outfight your opponent in this two-player head-to-head game to try to develop and sell your tea. That's basically it. No, I don't know if it's doing anything interestingly, amazingly unique or innovative, but it works. The gameplay works. It is a game that I've played several games and I want to return to it. The production quality is incredible, and it has the art and the production of Chai, but with a tighter, meatier experience for people like myself who wanted a tighter, meatier experience. And so that's Chai for Tea. That's Chai Tea for Two, one that you should be paying attention to. The next two, I don't have images for because I couldn't find anything online for them. So number two, or one technically, because Chai is 11. Number one is going to be Passengers. And it's worth noting that these aren't ranked in any particular order. This isn't like my most favorite to least favorite or vice versa. These are just general games that are on my radar. And Passengers is going to be a game in the vein of Coup, in the vein of Resistance, One Night Ultimate Werewolf, or any of those games. It is a hidden role game where you are ferrying souls to the underworld. And it's not amazing, not to me at least. It's not amazing, but then again, most of the games in the genre I don't consider amazing. I consider them fun, interesting, thinky, and giving me what I need. But Passengers is a game where the artwork is very unique. It stands out. I wish I could show you. I just don't have any images I can show you. And it's one that does things differently in the way that you are ferrying souls to the underworld, and every player gets assigned multiple souls, and there's this priority system of, depending on what team you're on, how you're trying to balance this navigation. And every time you load a soul onto a boat, there's two boats every single round, three rounds. Every time you load a soul onto a boat, you then take an action card, some sort of positive or benefit in some way that will help you. Then when all the boats are full, all the players start voting. Now, the two people who are trying to get the demons in or whatnot, they know who each other are in typical sense of one of these games. Everyone else is still trying to figure things out. And so it has that placement aspect of you are placing something that might be a bluff because it's not always guaranteed. So you have the opportunity to bluff, you have the opportunity to load boats, you have the opportunity to try to vote on which boat makes its way into the underworld, and then the configuration of the souls on these boats and how they will score. It's, again, I don't think it's breaking any barriers, the same way most of the games in the genre aren't. But it's thinky and it works well. And when I played it, I expected to say that's not doing anything new. And it kind of is. It kind of is doing something new. And the way the game interacts, it works. It's solid. It's one that I'm happy to add to my repertoire of Coup, One Eye Open Werewolf, Resistance, and others that I can't recall offhand, but games in that genre, so to speak. Number three, two. See, that happens when I just add games, I lose count. Number two is going to be Last Light by Roy Kennedy. Now, I've talked about this already before. This is going to be published by Grey Fox Games, and this is one that is a 4X asymmetric, not asymmetric, 4X, what's the word? Simultaneous play game. In the sense that every single round in this 4X game, every player picks a action that they are taking, and then you reveal and you resolve all those actions mostly simultaneously. Some of them you have to do in sequence and order because of the way they interact, and then you just continue doing that until someone wins. It's that simple, really. It's just a game where you develop, you build out your planets, you acquire resources, you use those resources to get other things, you get cards, special abilities, and all that. And my first play, I was incredibly impressed with it from the stance of it being a game we played online. We played it on Tabletop Simulator. And even then, even playing it online, it was a game that we got it done in, I can't remember what it was, it's been a while now, but I'm pretty sure we got the whole thing done with rules and online, 4 players, 4X game in an hour and a half, which is pretty impressive. Imagine what it would be in person. Imagine what it would be without the teach, because that was with the teach included. So I was impressed with the playtime, I was impressed with the experience. Similar to Passengers, to a certain extent, it's not going to be the most amazing game ever, or at least I should rephrase. Based on one play, I wasn't like, this is the best ever, but I was like, this was incredibly solid for an hour-long experience of a 4X genre. Incredibly solid. Now I want to play it more. I want to play it with the finished artwork, the finished production values. I can't wait to cover it for the Kickstarter, if I am. I don't know if I am, but hopefully I am, because I like it, so that seems like a good reason. But it's one that, I don't know. It's one that very much feels unique. I believe the concept of faster 4X games have been sold or pitched before. I don't think they've ever really delivered. And I think Last Light very much delivers in that sense. Number three is a game that is one that I wouldn't have thought that I would like. In fact, the correspondence I had back and forth with the developer, with the designer, or whoever it was that I said, oh, the game looks interesting, but it's not my genre of game. And it may still not be. In fact, there's going to be another game along these lines, and that I didn't throw into this, although I debated it, called Lost Empires, which just falls into the same genre. Both Lost Empires and Arackhan Wars, which you see on the screen in front of you, both those games are going to be two-player competitive games with a card-driven system. And I once put out a video a while ago that still remains true to this day, which was a video all about why I'm kind of done with two-player competitive card games. And that video may well hold up for both Lost Empires, which I'm technically not talking about right now, as well as Arackhan Wars. It may well be that Arackhan Wars is a game that ultimately is not for me. Because two-player competitive card experiences, I have found, generally wind up in a category where they are either simple enough that they don't give me enough depth, and there are going to be exceptions, games like Battleline, games like Hanamakoji, but those are very amazing games, by the way, to be clear. But the two-player competitive card games will either be simple enough where they don't give me enough depth, or alternatively, they are complicated enough that as one player gets better at the game, they start learning the other factions, other decks, other whatever it is. So you and I are playing, and I've played the game 17 times, you've played it twice, and I just know your cards better. And it puts an unbalanced situation on the table where one player plays it more than the other. That's generally, this is a 20-minute video I did a long point, I'm kind of condensing it down as to why, historically speaking, these kinds of games have not stayed in my collection. That said, it doesn't mean I'm not interested in them when they show up. And both Lost Empires, which we'll cover another time, and Arackhan Wars, which we're covering today, are games that did something differently to the point that I'm interested despite myself. Will it hold up long term? I don't know. It's also worth noting the art you see on the cards in front of you, not the final artwork. I've seen the new artwork. The cards are significantly prettier, better, whatever you want to call it. I don't know if the board is final, but this is all prototype stage. But effectively, you have this board, this grid, and you play cards down to the grid to enact a phase of attacking back and forth and doing what you need to do. But it's not really movement-based. There are cards that have movement abilities, but those tend to be the minority. It's all about setting up a grid. It's a placement slash building out your deck and your faction and all that. It really works well, and it was simple enough that it may well break that rule, that it may well end up in my collection as one of those two-player experiences I'm happy to own, to play. But it really, it was very decently done. Again, it's all about placing down your cards into a grid and then potentially taking out other cards, which will leave gaps, which will open the door for someone else to place cards in these grids, and you end up fighting in a back-and-forth way, but without movement. This is not Summoner Wars, where there you're going to be moving around the board with your factions, and nor is this Magic the Gathering, where it's all about, you know, just playing the cards and there's no degree of placement or knowing the area of the board. This is a hybrid model. There is a board, and movement, and not movement, placement matters immensely. It matters a lot. But also, you don't get to move unless you have a character that has a movement ability, which is going to be the minority. It ultimately ends up working very well with the abilities, the interplay, the scoring system, because it's not always about killing your opponent. It's about having the most points at the end of, if I'm not mistaken, 9 rounds, shows on the screen, at the end of 9 rounds. So Arackhan Wars is great. Solid. I was surprised despite myself. I literally messaged them and said, hey, there's a reason I don't like these games, but that said, I'm happy to give it a run through and see if it's for me. And so that one is one that, well, I'm excited about. Moving on from there, we have Vivid Memories. This is another one that's going to be hitting Kickstarter pretty soon, May 4th, if I'm not mistaken, which means I think Chai Tifa 2 is probably end of April. But Vivid Memories, coming May 4th, I think, to both of those, is going to be a game from, I don't remember who it's from. It's by artwork by what's it called, by Andrew Bosley. And the game is going to be from, let's see if we can find out who it's from. It's going to be by Floodgate Games. And this is one where you are, think inside out, think the memory aspect. You have this aspect of trying to develop your memories in this game, which is all abstracted. That's just a pasted on theme, but the theme ultimately works. As the game progresses, you're taking these cards with these like kind of memory tiles, these little blue, green, yellow, whatever, red, purple shapes that you'll be slotting into a grid. And as they form specific patterns, they will generate a memory, giving you a memory and actions that you can do. And then as you continuously fill up the grid, you start developing these connection points. And those connection points are worth points. And they're worth points every single round. So the earlier you can build out a connection point in a 3-round game, the more you can score giant chunks of points. You're constantly trying to manage your basic actions in the game, as well as the special actions that the cards give you, as well as trying to ensure that you set up your board in the correct way, as well as taking tiles from the center grid in a way that gets you the actions, get you the cards, get you the points, but doesn't lock up your board, lock up your grid. It is a thinky, puzzly system. It feels unique in the way it plays out. I mean, the general concept of many of the mechanics doesn't. Action selection doesn't feel unique. The way you take the tiles from the center grid, seen that before. But the way the player boards are built out, the way you develop your player boards, I wish I had a picture I can show you, but the way that all develops as you play out the game is pretty unique, as you build out these strings and then score multipliers based on having a bunch of memories of one particular type, one particular color, all locked together to edges of the grid, and then you slot things into these slots. You're building up a core memory, so to speak, as you play the game. Again, really works really well, manages to feel unique with a few mechanisms combined with a bunch of familiar mechanisms, and it's one that, and it's gorgeous. I mean, you saw the art, let's go back to the art. It's absolutely gorgeous. This is art by Andrew Bosley, and if you see back and forth, let's take a look. These are the front and the back of the card. So like, for instance, let's focus on this little child over here. Let's actually look at the other one. Let me see if I can find this here. Whoops, wrong way. So if you look at the art, you see over here, let's say this kid riding the bike. This is the kid riding the bike, and when you flip the tile, I'm messing this up over here. When you flip the tile, you get the kid riding the snowmobile. Effectively, all the cards are a balance between what's actually happening and then the way the kid is imagining what's happening, which is beautiful. Just very, very thematically well done. Moving on to some number that I don't particularly know, but this is one that I am very excited about. Not that the rest I'm not. I'm excited about all of these. But the next one up is going to be Oros, a game called Oros. And this is one where, let's go ahead and show you over here. Oros is a game where you are developing and building out islands as you play the game. It's a game where you're taking actions in order to construct the terrain around you, and it's so solidly tight. It's a first-time designer, I believe. It's one that I have the opportunity to play a few times already. This is one I have had multiple plays of, and I hope to be doing coverage for the channel at some point. But effectively, you are taking a variety of actions with your people, with your, I can't remember the name of the people, but these denizens of the universe, whatever they are, you put them on different slots to take actions, and those actions can be upgraded as the game develops. But the core of the game, the start of the game, is going to have you developing this island of shifting around land tiles to terraform the island. You're going to be building up volcanoes, merging, smashing together sections of land to grow more rocky, heavy, larger plots of land. As you merge together larger plots, you eventually form that volcano. As you form the volcano, you can actually start putting, you can start putting your temples on those mountains and slowly building up all these aspects, which will give you abilities, which will make you stronger in different ways. Maybe I can move my islands faster around the board. Maybe you can move your units faster. All these different things combined together in a tight engine of a game that is incredibly tight. Let's just say it already three times now. It's incredibly tense in what you're doing as you play. There's different ways you're scoring points. Every single time you build one of your temples, whatever it is, you're going to score points that way. As you move up these rows, you're going to score points for different types of things you've done throughout the game. As you move up the ability rows, you'll also score points there, and every single time you take certain actions. There are so many facets to how this game combines and the experience it delivers. It is both beautiful to look at. I'll throw a link, by the way, down below to the video for the game. There's like a trailer for the game. Watch that. So well done. This is one that absolutely should be on your radar. I don't know what's happening next with the company or with the game or anything else, but this is going places. This is going to be a game that people love. This is going to be a game that people seek out. It is going to do well on Kickstarter. I say that because every person I know who has played the game, and I know a lot of content creators who've had the opportunity to play the game online already, everyone I know who's played it has thought it was incredibly unique in the feeling it gives and incredibly well done in the experience it delivers. So pay attention to Oros because, well, it's coming to Kickstarter, I believe June. I could be wrong, maybe it's July, but sometime. From there, we have another one, which is one that I don't have. I have art of the game, which I'm going to show you because it'll hook you a bit. Hopefully, maybe not, who knows. But I don't have art of the game. And that's not because this doesn't exist. It's because the only art I do have is tabletop simulator art that doesn't look good at all and wouldn't make you enamored with it. So I'd rather sell you on it with my words because words matter. And that game is going to be Death Roads All-Stars. And Death Roads All-Stars, in fact, I'll hide myself completely so you can see the screen. This picture on the screen right here is Death Roads All-Stars. And it's one that, it's a game that's giving you, have you ever watched, I want to say Death Race, Jason Statham movie where he's in prison and racing to get out of prison while blasting people with his cars and his guns in a race. It feels like that movie personified. Death Roads All-Stars is a game where you're going to start the game by effectively building out your car. You're going to select a driver, a vehicle, and then select specific weapons to augment, to fit into that vehicle. Now, it's all card-based, to be clear. I mean, I think they will have miniatures in the Kickstarter, if I'm not mistaken, but it's mostly a card-driven game where you put down cards on a central board and then move them along and then play your weapon cards from your hand as you build your deck and then do what the weapon card says, and it doesn't really sound necessarily that interesting. I mean, it sounds like the kind of thing that in concept is a great game and in execution is going to be one of many forgettable games out there. Now, I can't promise it won't be forgettable. I've only played it once, after all, but I really enjoyed that play, and everyone who played it with me really did as well. Like, all three of us immediately said we want to cover this game. It was so much fun as we played out our cards, as we built our deck in the beginning of the game. We drafted our specific weapons, having in mind the placement, whether you're going to be ahead, behind, what you're going to do, and then we walked into the game, and it's not like a typical race in a typical sense. Rather, as one player moves off the board, it kind of pushes other people back, and they take damage or whatnot. You're trying to either win by getting to the end of the round and being the person in the lead, or alternatively ensuring that you're the last person standing. Either of those are completely viable ways of winning this game. Death Woods All-Stars feels great. Now, I recently talked about, what was the game? I recently did a racing game. It was Tiny Turbo Cars. Tiny Turbo Cars by Horrible Guild or whatever it was. And we played that game, and I really enjoyed it, and I backed it because of that. And I am excited for Tiny Turbo Cars, make no mistake. But the way someone else put it who was playing with us, Devin Norris from the Quackle team, the way he put it when we played the game, he said, it feels like Tiny Turbo Cars is the experience we're going to dive into when the kids are up and we want to have some fun. And then the kids are going to go to bed and we'll all grab, a few shots or some beers, whatever it is, and pull out Death Roads All-Stars and then just completely demolish each other as we play this game. And the art personifies that. The art of the game is excellent. The experience was excellent. At one point, we had our tracks narrowing and rocks falling down from the various sides of the mountain, and it wasn't a question of who was going to get damaged, but we were all going to get damaged, and the question was the timing of how it played out. Overall, Death Woods All-Stars, I'm very excited for. I don't know if it has legs. I don't know that. Hopefully it does, but it definitely has powers and abilities and definitely has fun play. It's possible that it's the kind of thing that, as I play it 3, 4, 5 times, eventually starts shifting down in my collection. No idea, but I don't think so. I think we liked it a lot. I mean, I know we liked it a lot. I think it holds up, though. Time will tell, but that's going to be Death Roads All-Stars. Moving on from there, we have one that I've talked about before, and this is going to be Velocity Vanguard. Velocity Vanguard is a Kickstarter that did fail already. It was, you know, it was on Kickstarter, and I talked about it at the time. It was a high price point. They didn't really have a lot of content creation around the game. It was a hard selling point of the game, and I still think the price point is high, and I hope that when it comes back to Kickstarter, I hope it does fun, because I very much want a copy of this game. Absolutely. Again, one play, grain of salt, all of that, but I absolutely want a copy of the game. It reminded me very much of Quad Heroes. Quad Heroes is a game that has this movement, pre-programming movement that you have built into the game, and you're trying to plan around how your quads are going to tumble around the board. And Velocity Vanguard is a very similar experience in the sense that you have this space map, this grid, that as you try to, you're trying to build out your ship's movement, but managing your drift, because you can accelerate, but then you have to ensure that what you do as you accelerate is still going to be true 2-3 rounds from now, as you constantly try to control and rein in the drift of your ship. It ends up being this weird, wacky movement thing where you have to figure out the movement, and then you blast the missiles off through space, and now you're trying to shoot the missiles, timing that the opponent's ship, while your opponent's trying to drift around the missiles, returning some sort of, dropping a mine in return. You're going to augment your ship, upgrade your abilities, and play across multiple scenarios that will constantly keep you on your toes, that will stop you from inherently learning and breaking the system. You're managing a very unique mechanism that I've never seen in games before, that concept of the drift that stays in play, and it does it so well. My biggest complaint was the table space this game takes up, and that was my biggest complaint. Biggest relative term. But yeah, overall, Velocity Vanguard is one that I am absolutely excited for, one that I'm paying attention to, and one that I'm anxiously awaiting its return to Kickstarter. It's originally supposed to be February, and it hasn't shown up yet. I'm waiting, and I'm interested in it. Moving on, we have Bantam West. Bantam West is going to be a game that is going to be, there's a term for it, an immersive sim is the term he uses. But effectively, it's a simulation game where you're going to walk into it. Now, people are going to want to compare it to Western Legends. I haven't played Western Legends yet. Hopefully, at some point, I do, so I can compare them before the Kickstarter goes up. But this is going to be a Western-themed game where you are managing your character, and you're trying to do a variety of things. You have a weapon deck that you're going to be building out and augmenting. You're going to be running around trying to upgrade your skills. Ultimately, you're trying to score 5, 10, 15, or 20 points, depending on the length of the game you're playing to. And every game length is going to have a different engine that best complements that gameplay. A game to 5 points can be a 45-minute long experience that you just rush for the points and play it very differently. Going to 10 points, 15, 20, now don't get me wrong, it's not going to be, you know, a 5-point game might be 45 minutes, a 10-point game is not going to be an hour and a half. It might be an hour and 15, because as you pick up steam in this game, as you start getting a mount or upgrading your skills, you will become better at getting those points, which means even a 20-point game might be a 3-hour long experience, might be. I've never actually played a 20 points, not yet. But this is one where you're building out your deck so that you can fight other players, because other players will try to fight you to take things from you. But you're also fighting the environment. You're going to be fighting creatures to take their skins, to mount their heads, to get points, to do what you need to do in this game. You're going to visit a variety of locations to get a mount, to get more crew to help you out, to get different augments or upgrades for your pack, to complete your skill set. There's so much going on in this game. It is fairly simple once you get the basic core mechanisms down. It's fairly simple. Ultimately, it comes down to moving around the board, taking actions, and trying to figure out the best way to slowly make your way to 20 victory points. It feels very sandboxy. Not completely sandboxy, but it feels fairly sandboxy in the experience it's giving. It works very well. The art's gorgeous. The miniatures, miniatures you can kind of see over there, but those are bad 3D resins. I'm curious what the miniatures will look like in the end. But the art's great. The gameplay's great. Teaches pretty quickly. Plays to a varying degree of playtime depending on what experience you're looking for. And that is Bantam West. I believe coming in June or July as well, if I'm not mistaken. Next up from there, we have Eos, Island of Angels, which I meant to look over here. You see, I forgot which tab I'm looking at. So we have Eos, Island of Angels. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5... 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Just making sure I have the right number of things. Here we go. Here's Eos Island of Angels. I am completely blanking on what I'm doing here. So, there's no picture. There's no good art for this one, unfortunately. Eos Island of Angels is going to be coming from King Raccoon Games. It's going to be by Grey Fox Games. Coming from King Raccoon Games, I think partnering with Grey Fox Games for distribution, something like that. But this is going to be a solid, I don't even know how to define this one. It's a challenging worker placement game with unique engine building mechanics, sort of. The worker placement part is really every player has their own unique faction of characters that you're going to take your workers, place them on your own characters to take the ability of that character, and then once the characters are all filled, you get to take a ship action, returning all your characters off. So it's kind of a place all your workers, recall all your workers kind of situation in the game. But the situation comes down to trying to battle for the resurrection of angels or the destruction of demons, and you have to balance that, or the demon lords or whatnot. And you're trying to balance and upgrade your ship so you become stronger in all these different facets. Do you want to become better at movement? Do you want to slowly upgrade your tableau? Do you want to improve your morale so you can actually tackle those angels and demons? Once you conquer an angel, it's going to to give you permanent upgrades. It's hard to describe this game, genuinely. It's very hard to describe this game without having a physical representation on the screen in front of me. But sadly, again, I couldn't find any particularly good art that would show you what this game is all about. There are player board images you can find, but everything's changing so rapidly. This is a game where they're still constantly playtesting. In fact, they pushed off the Kickstarter because they are still trying to playtest it out to build out a better experience. And I had the opportunity to play it last week, and I already read the rules. I kind of dropped it in a prior session, and I played it last week, and it's really solidly done. Lots of things to think about, but everything comes down to, first of all, asymmetric factions. Not the kind of asymmetry that's going to cross lines necessarily, but the kind of system where every player has a unique faction that's designed to deliver them the goal they want. What things they're going to be stronger in? Are they stronger in fighting? Are they stronger in movement? Are they stronger in completing quests? What is it that they can do better than other factions? And within that, you still have to figure out what engine you're going to move towards, which characters you're going to activate in what order, how are you going to puzzle your way through this system. The art is amazing. The variability from the variable factions, plus the cards you draw, plus all of that, again, amazing. The system itself is very solid. I don't know exactly where this lies in my collection long-term, because it did a lot of things really, really well. Part of the main board, or movement around the main board, was a little fiddly. But again, this goes back to the fact that they are still constantly playtesting it. Literally, dropping by one session 1 week and coming back 2-3 weeks later, so many things have changed. They are constantly iterating towards the best possible experience. And I'm very excited to see what the final preview looks like, as well as the final Kickstarter, when it actually shows up. Eos Island of Angels is one that, like many of these, you should absolutely be paying attention to. And I think that brings me to 10. Let me just make sure. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yes, number 10, I think, is going to be Distilled. Distilled is going to be a spirited strategy game. That's a cute little title there. And it's a spirited strategy game because it's about building spirits. Now, these stills over here, I would pay attention more to this art. This art is going to be across the game. But these stills are here from Tabletop Simulator. And it's all about crafting spirits. That's what it is. It's a semi-deck builder, but not really. It has hints of a deck builder, hints of tableau building, as you slowly but surely across 7 rounds try to distill and build the best alcohol. Not build, distill the best alcohol, the most desired spirits in all the land, or something along those lines. You're going to start off the game by crafting, you know, cheap vodka or moonshine or whatever it is as your basic, you know, spirits that will get you a few points, get you some money, and start building up your engine. Across the next rounds, you can build up your engine by hiring different workers, by having unique characters, having a whole bunch of things that improve your skill, that improve your ability, your tableau, effectively giving you unique advantages as the game progresses. Every time you distill an alcohol, you have a choice. Not every time, it depends on the alcohol you distill. But the alcohol choices, as you distill them, you have the opportunity to either let them age and get you more points, more of a sale down the road, but you're giving up that income and that now, and you need the income now, so you have to balance that in the game. Alternatively, you just turn around and sell it, and the cards you get will all cater you towards different benefits, different reasons. Plus, there's goals in the game that will give you a reason to, perhaps I was going to age that thing a few more rounds, but this tells me that if I age it now and I sell it now with a few flavor cards, I'll get some extra points. It's very unique in the theme it's presenting, and it's very well done in the execution of that theme. And the art is gorgeous. Everything about the game is intriguing. Again, one play. So I still need to see exactly where it ends up, and I'm not saying it's without complaints. I still have some finicky parts about complaints that feedback I've given. I'm waiting to hear back how things are, if they are changing or not. But even in its current state, it is one that is absolutely worth paying attention to. And that's going to be our 10th game. That's it. That's going to be this series, so to speak. This is a series that is not going to be on any particular timeline. Effectively, every single time I have a bunch of upcoming Kickstarters that I can talk about, things I'm excited to see, games that I think I will be backing and adding to my collection. Well, whenever I have a chunk of them, let's say at least 5, I think a minimum of 5 is needed, I'll do one of these videos about upcoming Kickstarters that I'm paying attention to that I think you should as well. Doesn't mean they'll be a game for you, not in the slightest, but they're games that I liked at the very least, and you might like them too. Possibly, maybe, who really knows? Until next time, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co. And I hope you enjoyed this video. Genuinely, this is a new one. So new mini-series thrown onto the channel. If you did enjoy it, let me know, because that makes it more likely that it'll come back next time. And until next time, have a good one.